Okay. Good morning, everybody. Welcome today for this webinar. Today we have the presenter that is Dr. Erdal Özkan from Colorado School of Mines, and he's going to be talking about the topic "Big Solutions to Small Problems." Okay, so everything related to enhanced oil recovery and apply for unconventional reservoirs. So, Dr. Özkan, welcome and good morning. How are you?
Good morning. I'm good. Thank you.
Okay, I hope you had a happy Thanksgiving day, okay?
It was great. Thank you.
Okay, well, so we are gonna start right now, okay? So first of all, I just wanna introduce myself. Today, my name is Bruno Armando Lopez Jimenez, and today I'm gonna be the moderator of this webinar. So the project or this event is called Ponencias DICT, and the slogan that we have is Bridging the Industry with the Academia. So any comments or suggestions that you might have, please follow our social media, either Facebook or LinkedIn, or you can just send an email through the email that you can see in your screen, that is webinars.dcit.unam@gmail.com. So again, thank you for being here and taking some time of your busy agenda to attend this webinar. Yeah. So we usually have a poll that is related to the topic that is going to be explained today. And so in that way, you can share your opinion and also the answers with the other audience and also with the speaker. So please, right now, you should be able to see the poll. So the poll is going to be open right now. So we will appreciate that you can answer the poll. So any. So the question is this one: if you were in charge of the implementation of an EOR technique in an unconventional reservoir, how will you decide the best method to apply in this unconventional reservoir? It will be either based on the analogs, okay? It could be either also based on the EOR screening that it was developed for conventional reservoirs. Maybe you might say, okay, it could be selected based on reservoir simulation studies, or you might have any other question. So, Dr. Özkan, I think you might be talking about this. Is that right?
That's correct. We are going to get into this discussion in a little bit.
Okay, perfect. So let's see what the people think about this question. So I'm gonna give just like a minute or something like that. Yeah, so we have some answers of the audience. Okay. So let's see. I guess it should be enough. Okay, so I'm gonna close the poll right now, and then I'm gonna share the results with everybody. So it's right now just submitting all the responses. Okay. You should be able to see the results of the poll. Yeah, so it's just like counting down. There you are. So, Dr. Oskin, can you see the results of the poll so you can have an idea about the audience opinion?
Oh, yeah, I think it's selection C, right?
Yeah, selection C. Yeah, so the option C, it's whatever they think that it should be selected. Any EOR technique that might be implemented in unconventional reservoir should be based on reservoir simulation studies. So you might tell us your opinion later during the presentation. Is that
I played it safe. I selected other,
right? You
which means you should
selected.
use everything. Yes.
Okay. You select. Okay, that's a good answer. Okay, so thank you for the participation. Again, this is just a way to have some interaction with the audience. So thank you for the participation. Okay, so as I said at the beginning of this broadcast, our speaker for today, it's Dr. Erdal Özkan from Colorado School of Mines, and the topic is gonna be big solutions to small problems. So I'm gonna read a short bio from the Dr. Özkan. So Dr. Oskan is a professor of petroleum engineering, as I said before, at the Colorado School of Mines. He's the director of the Unconventional Reservoir Engineering Project and co-director of the Marathon Center of Excellence for Reservoir Studies. He is a distinguished member of the SPE and currently serves as the Reservoir Technical Director of the SPE International Board of Directors. He received the SPE Lester Juring Award in 2013, the Formation Evaluation Award in 2007, and the Rocky Mountain North America Reservoir Description and Dynamics Award in 2018. During the period 2011-2012, he was a SPE Distinguished Lecturer on Shale Gas Reservoirs. And he's gonna be talking, actually, today he's gonna be talking about unconventionals. So that's a good way to summarize everything, yeah? So before we start, I just wanna say that after the presentation, we are gonna have a Q&A session, okay? So you can send us any question that you might have through the Q&A icon that is available on your WebEx application. Yeah, so if you are using a laptop or a computer, the Q&A icon should be right here. So please send any question that you might have through that icon. And if you are using a mobile, any mobile, a cellular or something like that, in order to get the Q&A icon, you should click on these three dots, and after that, it's gonna pop up the new window, and you can click on the Q&A icon, and you can send the question, yeah? So please feel free to send any question that you have, okay? So with that said, I just wanna say that we can start, Dr. Oskan, with the presentation. So right now, let me just give you the role of presenter, okay? And please let me know if you can share your screen, okay? So it should be right now available for you.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Can you see my screen now?
Yeah, it's right there, yeah.
Excellent. Okay, let me try to expand more into.
Yeah, it might be just on the, yeah, right there. Yeah, it's right
okay.
there.
Okay. All right. Thanks again, Bruno, and I appreciate this invitation. And as Bruno introduced the topic today, is about unconventional reservoirs, and basically it's about the EOR discussions. The reason I selected that one is because it's a timely topic, and there are a lot of discussions around understanding unconventionals and applying enhanced oil recovery in these reservoirs, but I believe we have a lot of unknowns at this point. And I would like to open up some of these questions today. So let's first of all look at the reality. In about the early 2000s, we started this so-called unconventional revolution. But if you look at the average production of a lot of unconventional wells, you're going to see that there is a very high initial recovery, and then goes through a very fast decline. And except for this initial rates, the recovery factors in unconventionals are extremely low. So that's a big problem. And under any other circumstances, this type of recovery factors would not really allow us to go into a real development scheme, but the financial structure applied in unconventional setups, which is mostly borrowed money from banks or Wall Street and so on and so forth, basically a bunch of investors pumping money into unconventional fields, we could continue this development. However, we cannot really keep investing or reinvesting into drilling and fracturing. And it happened recently you can remember that about even before this pandemic, Wall Street decided that they would not invest into unconventional projects unless they saw some return, actual return, because the main idea here was that we would pretty much get the money and reinvest it into the next project. So it was a continuous cycle. There are a lot of problems with this beyond just the financial issue. Investors would like to see some cash coming back to their pocket. But there are other things like limitations in terms of environmental issues and concerns about the footprint these unconventional projects create. So these days, we would like to reduce our footprint. That means we need fewer wells and higher, longer-term recoveries to make sure that we can actually show that we are profitable, but at the same time, we are not causing, as they claim, a lot of harm to the environment. So, with this introduction, now I would like to get into the details a little bit. Normally, when we talk about unconventionals, we bring our some 100 years of conventional perceptions into the discussion. So there are a lot of conventional solutions we have developed. They are available to us, but they do not necessarily work at this unconventional scale. So sometimes it's useful to remind what type of scale we are talking about. If this is your hair at the top, human hair, then unconventional pores will be at the bottom of this scale. And you can also see the comparison with the conventional pores here. So we are dealing with the unconventional pores in the low nanometer sizes. But what we do these days, and especially in converting our conventional wisdom into unconventionals, we basically extrapolate primary recovery dynamics into the future. But when you realize that the remaining oil is stuck in this 1 to 10 nanometer size pores, then the remaining fluid is going to be in an extremely tight space. And in this space, even our flow dynamics may be different. So let's first ask this question, what is really unconventional in unconventionals? And just to give you again a sense of the scale, I put a methane molecule, which is the smallest hydrocarbon molecule. And next to it, you have the Barnett pore, which is on the average about 5 nanometers. So you can put somewhere between 10 to 15 methane molecules into the space. And the reason we are just missing some of the unconventional aspects of flow is because of the fact that most of our conventional understanding is about bulk fluid movement. When we talk about bulk fluid, we basically have hundreds, thousands, or millions of molecules in a pore space, and most of these molecules are sitting in the middle of the space, and their internal interactions are much more important than the interactions with the surface of the pore. So that is actually the basis of Darcy's law. But when you come to this very small level, individual molecular level interactions and interactions with the pore surface become more important. So we are talking about a description of flow, not at the bulk fluid level, but at this molecular level. So when we start thinking this way, we also notice that our oil production from tide formations is mostly very light fluids, 50-55 API gravity oil. So you say we are sure that there is oil under the ground which is much heavier than this. Therefore, there should be some type of filtration happening when this fluid comes to the surface. And this is not a new realization, because long ago, geologists recognized that the shale had some membrane properties. And we start with this observation, and we looked at some core experiments in our research group, and we also we could show the hindered transport in these unconventional cores. So during this talk, I will just try to show you some unconventional aspects, and I need to warn you that what I'm going to show you today is not necessarily everything is happening in unconventionals. I'm mostly focusing on the tight matrix, very small pore sections. And in this case, I'm going to emphasize the hydrocarbon filtration and retention mechanisms in nanoporous media and what this implies on EUR technologies, and also how we can put those into some models. So first of all, I would like to show you two pictures here. On the left, what's called a depth filter, and on the right, actual mudstone. You can see the similarities of these pore structures. So when you identify this visual, I'm sorry, why is this moving? When you see this visual resemblance, then you can start looking at the different filtration systems. There are two types of filters used in commercial applications. One of them is stream filtration, in which what you need to, or what you want to filter, is going to be rejected by the small size of filter channels. And the second one is depth filtration. And in this one, your molecules can move into the filter, but due to the dead end pores and some small pore spaces or pore torts and everything, they can be captured in the filter. And this is more like what we are observing in our unconventional reservoirs. And the process here may be molecular sieving because of size, and the selective adsorption, and so on and so forth. So that's just an orientation, so to speak, about the filtration concept we are looking at in this presentation. And initially, when we started these discussions, the easiest thing to do was to build a thermodynamics model. And we looked at it, we put a fixed concentration into two boxes connected by a small, relatively small opening. And some of these molecules could easily pass through this connecting channel. Some others would be a little bit more difficult to pass through, and some of them could not pass. And then we applied some pressure on one side using a piston, and we looked at the final concentration of different components. And in the end, we defined the filtration efficiency term, and the filtration efficiency in this example is between C6 and C7. C7 being larger molecules, they are being filtered here. And in the end, we could see that the filtration efficiency at a given pressure basically decreased when the pressure decreased. So there was some change in the filtration characteristics of the medium. And we wanted to expand this research a little bit more. And then we went into experiments with actual codes. Here you have two sets of experiments. In the first set, you have an iBrota code, and here we inject C10 and C17 mixture, and here the first blue dot is the injected fluid composition, and the red dots, they are the effluent fluid compositions. You can see that the C10 or the lighter component, smaller molecule composition, starts increasing in the effluent fluid. That means C17 is being retained in the system. So this is for the differential pressure of 2000 psi. When we did the same experiment with our standard conventional barrier core, you could not see any change in the concentrations. So that means in a NIBROTA core, the pore sizes are so small that we start seeing this filtration behavior, which was not an issue in the conventional systems. And that's why we never paid attention to filtration or this retention concept. So we call this a selective hindrance in nanopores or nanopore toads. And this selective hindrance causes a compositional change during a transport in unconventional reservoirs. And the reasons for those may be proximity of nanopore sizes to hydrocarbon molecules, strong dependence of global flow on microscopic phenomena. And normally, if you flow the fluid at much higher velocities in more higher permeability media, then your pore scale Navier-Stokes effects can be averaged out to yield a dust-like flow. But at this very small scale and very slow flow, this averaging is no longer possible. So you need to pay close attention to molecular level interactions. So when we talk about selective hindrance, this name or this notation may be confusing. So I want to just make sure that we explain it as the aggregate effect of hydrocarbon retention mechanisms which cause a compositional change. So it may be preferential absorption, size exclusion, like the sieving, physical filtration, or any other mechanism. But we are basically saying that any type of molecular level effect which hinders the flow of fluids will be considered as a selective hindrance. So here I just briefly show you the setup we used for the core test, and it's basically a small sample we put in the core holder here. And as I said, these are NIBROTA pore toads, about 10 to 100 nanometer in size. And the hydrocarbon sizes we use in these experiments, you can see that it's in the range of 0.4 to 1 to 3 nanometers. So there is definitely enough opening for the hydrocarbon molecules to pass through, but the smaller molecules will be expected to pass easier than the larger ones. We did not use cores with fractures or high conductivity pads. So this was one note. And also these are mostly inorganic cores. So that's important because organic cores would have more absorption type of behaviors. And the pressures were below bubble point pressure. So we are not looking at any issue like miscibility here. So it's quite fashionable these days. We are trying to inject a bunch of different gas compositions into these reservoirs for enhanced oil recovery. CO2 is one of them. And we tried CO2 huff and puff in these experiments. And you can see that in this core test, the first part indicates that C10 or the smaller molecule concentration increases, meaning that there is some retention of the heavier, larger component. And then at this point here, we inject CO2, soak it for a while, and then start producing. Now you can see that it starts quite low here. That means C10 concentration goes down, which implies that C17 concentration has increased as a result of CO2 injection. So CO2 seems to mobilize more C17 or heavier components, but eventually C10 concentration go back to the same level. So you need to go into a new half cycle, new injection cycle. Of course, this is a core experiment. We wanted to understand more about this process by running some molecular dynamics simulations. And this is a simulation representing our basically calcite-rich cores. And without CO2 in the system, you can see that C17 heavier molecules are very much aligned along the surface of the core, calcite. So calcite would like to absorb C17 more than C10. But when you put CO2 into the system, now you can see that CO2 is basically absorbed on the surface of calcite. And by doing this, it moves C17 into the main flow stream, and you start seeing more CO2, I mean C17 in your flow. So that was an idea to explain what was happening here. And basically, we are saying that the preferential absorption of CO2 over C17 is probably the source of this increased production of heavier components. Now, of course, another option is to use methane, because we have a lot of produced gas in these fields, and instead of flaring them, it would be nice to inject them into the system as an enhanced oil recovery agent. And here, we used the three different Nivrora samples, and we used the Nivrora crude oil. And this was dead oil, but in the end, when we looked at it without CH4 in the system and with CH4 in the system, we did not really see any considerable increase in production. So that was a little bit surprising to us. But when you look at this in molecular dynamics simulations, you can actually see a behavior which is different from what we demonstrated with CO2. In CO2, we saw that the CO2 wanted to be absorbed on the surface, which displaced heavier hydrocarbons and moved them into the main stream of flow. But here, you don't see the same thing. CH4 does not get absorbed on the surface. Therefore, it does not have any effectiveness in terms of removing heavier hydrocarbons from the calcite surface. So this is, of course, a restricted experiment. And we also know some results. People have reported that the methane is actually increasing the production. So we wanted to look at these different effects. But at this point, just to give some summary of what we saw between methane and CO2. We can say that CO2 was more effective in these experiments in terms of increasing production rate and the production of heavier hydrocarbons compared to methane. And we could also see that this was mostly about the preferential absorption. So this was the mechanism. And probably the effect of CH4 could be mostly evaporation of some of these heavier hydrocarbons, but because we used only one type of core and one type of fluid and everything, we could not really express these conclusions as a general result. So we wanted to do a little bit more investigations, and we looked at the system. In this simulation here, you can see a molecule in a given pore space, and there is another cavity next to it. These two are connected with a pore throat, a small pore throat. And when you give it an agitation, this molecule starts moving in this pore space and bumping through the walls. At some point, it catches the right angle to pass through this opening and finds itself in the another cavity and keeps doing the same thing. Assuming that these cavity sizes are the same, if you look at the position or the displacement of this molecule in this pore, you can see that this average level is about the size of this pore. And then there is a big jump, which represents the time period when this molecule moves through the opening, and then it keeps doing the same thing in the other pore. It's a steady movement. So when you look at this one, you say that if this is a statistical system, then the more movement this molecule does in the system, it gets a better ability or better opportunity to find the opening and jump into the next pore space. And actually, there are some simulations done in this one, and people have shown that when you look at, for example, oxygen, methane, and helium, oxygen being the small, being the largest, and helium being the smallest molecule, you can see that in the same time period, helium makes many more jumps, and it is much more active, being a smaller molecule. So size actually does matter, and I would like to show you this simulation here. In this case, we have methane and heptane in the one side of this tube, and oops, if I can start the simulation. Now you can see that the smaller one, which represents methane, it has already found this opening and moved to the other one. And it's basically traveling much faster in the system. And then heptane finds its way, but it's actually blocked by the smaller methane molecule here. And even when it finds the opening, it is still stuck. It cannot proceed. So this is just a basic the cartoon, so to speak, to demonstrate the mechanism. But when we did some more molecular dynamic simulations, we could show that the diffusivity coefficient of different components in an oil mixture in the presence of CO2 or in the presence of CH4, they show a lot of differences. So you can see that this is hexadecane. Its diffusivity coefficient is small, and then octane, and then you can see CH4 has much more mobility. Its diffusivity coefficient is large, and then you have butane, and pentacosane has the smallest one. So basically, these simulations indicate that CO2 and CH4 injection increases the mobility of the hydrocarbon molecules, but it's a selective effect. And the CO2 is also efficient at sweeping hydrocarbons from pore surface to the center due to absorption disruption mechanism. But CH4 looks more effective at increasing the diffusivity of hydrocarbons. So the reason I'm bringing this up is because there are a lot of ideas circulating in our technical communities these days. People are trying to apply some existing technologies. Like they say, let's inject some surfactant because it has been shown to work in in conventionals. Here, I can show you the sizes of a nano-emulsion droplet or micro-emulsion droplet here, and this is basically what happens when you inject surfactant into these pore spaces. And remember, they are in the size of 5 to 10 nanometers most of the time, where the oil is stuck. And this microemulsion droplet is actually much, much larger than the size of the openings. So if you are trying to mobilize the fluid stuck in the system, first you need to get your injected fluid surfactant into this space. And then when it forms this microemulsion, it does not actually flow through these small openings anymore because its size is large. That's why we are looking at the gases like CO2 or methane, because their size is probably much more amenable to flow in these small openings. So that's one thing. And the other idea is that I was just mentioning in the beginning of my, I'm sorry, this keeps moving on me. In the beginning of my presentation, that we have to look at it closer and try to find out if there are any other mechanisms we can identify to contribute flow. So at the same time, we hear about gas injection concept. People say gas injection works in unconventional, but there is not just one type of gas. There are different type of gases, and each type may activate a different mechanism. So it's a dangerous move to put all the gases into the same category and assume that they are going to be doing the same thing. These days, the fashionable thing is to talk about miscibility of these gases, how much more miscibility you obtain at this pressure level, at that pressure level. And remember, all what I showed you here, these are below miscibility pressures. So we're just trying to bring a different perspective to this discussion. Finally, I would like to say a few things about the modeling. If you proceed in that direction, you would like to present a formulation for this type of flow. And it's relatively simple here. We have a diffusional flux and advective flux, which is the main gas flow component. And then the storage terms here, the conventional ones and the absorption, and then sieving, whatever else is keeping the molecules, which is mostly a steric effect. Now, when you move with this type of formulation, the issue is to find out these additional terms. It's standard to use this diffusional term here. And then in this case, you need to calculate this binary diffusion coefficient, for example, if you are looking at the hindered and unhindered parts. So this requires some molecular dynamic simulations or experimentation, and you need to know the tortuosity of the system. And then you have the absorption term. There are some absorption models like this, and these models would require some parameters like MI and AS here, which I will briefly mention. These would come from some experimental approaches. And then you can also use this sieving term here. We basically use this simple model here, but again, N sub I and S sub I will be determined through molecular dynamic simulations. So there are some models for those. I'm not going to go into these model details, but let me tell you how these models would work. Here we have a binary mixture, and basically we get the binary diffusion coefficient and everything. This can be obtained from molecular dynamic simulations. And then for the absorption and sieving part, there are two unknowns. One of them is M, which is the speed coefficient for absorption. And for the sieving part, S sub max and N are the unknowns. So basically, when we run the experiments, we try to fit our experimental results with this model, and we obtain M, S max, and N coefficients. And in the end, we actually get some representation of our experimental results through some formulation, and we were successful. But let me tell you where we are right now. First of all, in our interpretation, organic rich content does not form a continuum. So we say that it's more important to look at the inorganic matrix at this point. And also we expect microscopic and macroscopic heterogeneities to play an important role in defining the dominant transport. And of course, comparison of CH4 and CO2 injection results indicate that there is no universal gas injection EOR theory. So we need to look at everything in its special conditions. And also people say that if I don't have CO2, I can use CH4, or if I don't have CH4, I can look for CO2, or when there is a carbon tax credit and things like this. But these are economics or availability type of concerns. However, depending on the special type of your crude oil and the pore space and everything, there may be a range of application for different types of gases. So it's a mistake to think that any gas would work. You just have to choose it based on economics. And where we go from here, basically, we need to do more field scale modeling with hindered transport. And we are building some numerical models for those. These are compositional models. Of course, we will need some pilot projects for that. But just to show you that there are many other possibilities, we also tried some carbon monoxide injection, and they showed some promising results in some cases. Basically, when you have more clay content in the core, because field tests indicate that carbon monoxide has a permeability enhancement effect. It's a reducing agent which reduces metal oxides. So this shrinks the clays, and it expands the pore space or pore channels. So carbon monoxide liberates water attached to swelling clays and reduces the diameter. So the permeability of the rock is enhanced. So that means if you have some clay-rich formation, you can also try carbon monoxide. This was just a comment to show that we have many different possibilities. We should not just try to impose our ideas coming from conventional systems, like CO2 is required for miscible flooding or surfactant does this and that. There may be a lot of other options, and we need to keep our options open. So I will leave it at this point, and I will be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Özkan. So we're going to start the Q&A session right now. So please send all the questions that you may have. So the idea with this one, I'm going to be reading the questions, Dr. Özkan, and then you're going to be giving the answers. Is that okay for you?
Of course.
Okay, there you are. So let's start with the questions. So the first question that we have is, you were talking about CO2 or methane, and somebody's asking if it is possible to use nitrogen or not.
Nitrogen did not show
Dr. Özkan, I think you muted your mic.
Okay. Thank you. In the experiments, nitrogen did not seem to be a very effective agent so far. There are some field trials. So there is not much interest in the use of nitrogen. That's why we have not really looked at nitrogen. But again, as I said, that there may be some special conditions where nitrogen might help. But it's not one of the heavily considered options at this moment.
Okay. And well, for example, having some rich gases, like a combination, a mix of different gases, is that an option or not?
It's definitely an option. And one of the concerns here is that we usually try to inject what's available in the field.
Okay.
That's why we focus on the CO2 and produce gas. But CO2 is not that easy to find everywhere. And sometimes when you talk about capturing and injection, it becomes even more expensive in that case. And also there are a lot of conventional fields where CO2 can be used. That's why produced gas is probably a more favored solution. So at some point in my presentation, I said that you cannot make the choice based on economics. You have to find out what works, but that doesn't mean we can ignore economics. What I meant to say is that you cannot assume that any gas would have the same effectiveness. So just because you have, for example, produced gas, doesn't mean it's going to do the same thing as CO2. So you need to understand what it is going to do before you apply it. That was the objective. And the lean gas injection, it has been discussed, but it has not gained a lot of traction.
Okay. Okay, so we have this this question. So it says I'm gonna say the name, since he was a grad student over there at Colorado School of Mines. His name is Franklin Useche. Good morning, Dr. Oskar. Thanks for the interesting presentation. How do you think the experimental modeling findings will change if evaluated under reservoir conditions? I mean, non-Darcy flow mechanisms are thought to become significant at low pressure, low reservoir pressure.
Yes, when we look at some of these reservoir conditions, we actually see a lot of things changing. So right now, we are just trying to demonstrate the mechanisms, the main mechanisms, but the scale at which they apply, they may change. And some of these non-Darcy type of flow effects actually are included in our modeling so far, because we look at it at the molecular level. And Darcy flow is a bulk flow system, and most of its assumptions are based on the fact that you're neglecting molecular level interactions. So we are considering some of them already in this level, but not all of them, definitely, and we keep that in perspective.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Oskan. I think you are like also looking at the questions, yeah? So
yes, I think we have two, three questions from my dear friend Rodolfo Camacho, right?
Oh, okay, yeah, let me see. I might have it over here. Well, I think Dr. Camacho sent it just to you, because I don't see anything. Yeah, I don't see
anything. And I don't see the others. Okay.
So you have some questions, and I also have some other
All
questions.
Right.
Yeah? So maybe you can read the question from Dr. Camacho, and you can answer the question. Yeah.
I'll do that. And Rodolfo asks is it reasonable to talk in the modeling to consider organic and inorganic matrix? Well, definitely it's important, and you can look at the differences between organic and inorganic content. One striking difference, for example, if you talk about CO2, and if you consider this absorption property, you realize that the absorption is much, much stronger on organic surfaces. So everything we talked about is going to change. Probably it's going to be elevated to that level. And there is also a special reason. For example, if you are thinking about the CO2 injection, and if you are doing this for carbon credit, you would like to have your injected CO2 to stay in the formation. You don't want to produce it. Mm-hmm. So this absorption is a good property. Then in that case, the more organic content, the better the application possibility. But if you are talking about produced gas injection, especially these days, slowly gas prices started increasing, and people are predicting some more increase in gas prices. So if you inject your produced gas into the system, and if you do not get it back to the surface, then you're going to be in trouble. You're going to feel the shortage of produced gas after a while. So in that case, probably less organic content would be a better option. But at the same time, produced gas seems to be working through a different mechanism. Mm-hmm. So you need to understand that. Basically, it's case dependent, and you need to look at both organic and inorganic matrix. But in our case, we think that organic material is basically encapsulated in the organic material. So to be able to reach the organic content, first you need to penetrate through the bulk of inorganic matrix. So if you cannot explain it in inorganic matrix, it does not really make much sense to look at the organic content. So it's a convoluted question, but basically it's very important. Now the next question Rodolfo has, if in unconventional reservoirs, the threshold pressure gradient that exists in low permeability reservoirs is also present in unconventional reservoirs. The short answer, yes, definitely. And we have not really paid much attention to this one in our modeling, and we need to look at this. And also Rodolfo is asking about skim zone around hydraulic fractures in unconventional reservoirs. Yes, there is some skim zone, but mostly because hydraulic fractures are also initiating all these natural fractures. I think this skin is not the conventional skin we think about in conventional reservoirs, because in conventional systems, your injected fluid penetrates into the matrix and blocks some of these flow channels. But in this case, the flow is mostly from the matrix into small natural fractures, and then from natural fractures to hydraulic fractures. So as long as your natural fractures are open, you do not really expect much damage in the system. But again, it's still an open area. You can do some research there.
Okay, there you are. Okay, so thank you, Dr. Oskan, for reading the questions. You might have some other ones, so I'm going to read some other ones from here. Yeah.
Please do, because there is one here which is in Spanish. I apologize. I don't speak Spanish.
Well, you might try, Dr. Oskan. Yeah, you might try. Okay, so just a quick question related to whatever you said about this absorption. And for example, you were explaining that for methane, the main mechanism, or the, we can say the main effect, it's on the diffusivity coefficient, yeah? And for the CO2, it's mainly on the absorption part. And you presented some cases for the calcite and C10 and C17. So my question is this: what happens if you change the surface? For example, if you don't have calcite, if you have some other surface, the results are going to be the same, or is it just because this affinity of the calcite with the CO2, or it doesn't depend on the surface?
It should definitely change. That's why we are saying that it's not about one type of mechanism. I think whatever injection mechanism you are trying to investigate, you have to run all these different experiments. You need to find out first what the retention mechanism is, what keeps the oil in the system, and then find out what is going to be more active, more efficient to removing this flow. For example, we said that in the application of C17, originally C17 was stuck on the surface, calcite surface. So when you inject CO2, because CO2 wants to be absorbed on the surface, C17 is pushed into the mobile phase. So that's definitely a mechanism. But if you don't have a system where your heavier hydrocarbons, for example, are retained in on the surface of the pore space, then you cannot rely on absorption desorption type of concept. Okay. So it all depends on what type of system you have, what type of fluid you have, and what is available to inject. That was my objection from the beginning. Just saying that gas injection, you are as if it is one single system, one single mechanism applicable in all types of formations. There is no such thing.
Okay. Yeah, for sure. Thank you, Dr. Oskan. So we have another question, comment from Dr. Roberto Aguilera. Yeah, so he says, excellent presentation. Thank you. And he's saying, ConocoPhillips drilled a fantastic research well in the Eagle Ford shale where they collected a lot of data. Using this data and improved completions, ConocoPhillips in 2018 reported they had oil recoveries of more than 20% in some parts of the Eagle Ford. Thus, they are bringing a different perspective to oil recovery in shales based on hard field data. Do you think this Eagle Ford shale recovery by ConocoPhillips is reasonable or not?
I think it's reasonable. And one of the problems we have right now is ConocoPhillips have some data. And we have some data from, for example, EOG wells, but as much as they publish. And some other companies are running some pilots these days. So we need to definitely look at all these different data and then understand what's applicable. Most importantly, we need to come up with some screening criteria. And unfortunately, it's not that inexpensive to run these pilots and collect all the data. So the best thing to do for the industry is to collect all this data, process it, and come up with some sound screening criteria, try to prove these different enhanced oil recovery or improved recovery mechanisms, and then everybody can benefit from it. But right now, I think there are a lot of speculations. When people say it's working, we don't really understand what's working. I can give you a very simple example here. A lot of discussions, they indicate the baseline production decline, and then they say that I stopped production, I did some huff and puff, I reopened the well, and I got this increase in production, this jump. Well, you can also stop producing for a while, and even if you don't inject anything into the system, next time when you open the well, you're going to start at a higher rate, mm-hmm. new transients, okay? So how much of this increase in production is due to your injected agent, or is it just kind of restarting the transients? So how do you optimize these types of processes? And I think I appreciate the initial poll you had, and a lot of people said that we need to run some simulations to understand what's happening in the long run, because some field production and extrapolating this increase in production in the long term may not be sufficient because there is not enough data at this point. We need to do some simulations, but when we do the simulations, we need to also understand that the simulation has to cover all these different physical mechanisms we have to include in the model? So that's an indirect question to Dr. Aguilera's question. I appreciate it. And I am very much looking forward to receiving more data and trying to test all these ideas.
Okay. So based on that reservoir simulation studies that you mentioned, Dr. Oskan, just talking about the commercial ones, yeah, it's like, as you said, they have to include all the physics related to the to the shales and everything. So how do you think, like, about, because since we're talking about big projects, yeah, big reservoirs, like thousands or millions, yeah, millions of cells and everything, and sometimes for these in-house simulators developed, I don't know, by a company or developed by a university, the main issue is about the speed, yeah, the CPU time and everything. So how do you handle that situation in which when you have the commercial ones that are really fast and they can handle these thousands and millions of cells, and you have the other ones that are the in-house simulators that they have all the physics, but maybe in terms of the CPU time, they might be a little bit behind the commercial ones?
Well, that's an excellent question. In fact, this probably exposes one of the deficiencies we have at the moment. First of all, we are not scientists. We are engineers in this discussion. So we are not trying to model something in full detail. And I can just give this example, like, you know, you take a picture of someone for a passport and it has to look exactly like you, okay? But if you want to make an art piece, you know, it's your observation and it should give me the image of something. It may not look exactly like this, but if it gives me the sense of color, if it gives me the smell of the flower or whatever, somehow, that's sufficient. So in reservoir simulation, this is exactly what we are doing. We are not creating a picture of it. We are creating an image of the reservoir as we perceive it. So basically, it's the cliche that all simulators, all models are approximations. Simulation is an approximation too. It has to be. We cannot expect that all the physical understanding of flow details will go into simulations. But first, you need to lay them down, you need to test them, and find out which ones are really effective, which ones can be assumed as negligible, and you have to keep them in mind every time, because when there are some new constellations, you may realize that there's some of the physical mechanisms you neglected, they need to be turned on. But we have to go through the screening process, and then we have to come up with a new set of simulators which can be practically applicable, but at the same time cover the most important mechanisms. So at this point, we have some simulators which are mostly serving the conventional systems, and the unconventional features, it's not because we don't know them, it's simply because they are not included in simulators. It's a huge cost to put those into simulators. So that's part of the problem at this point. And I guess the biggest question is this: we still do not understand the primary recovery in unconventionals. So this question is not about enhanced oil recovery. We still do not know, we still do not understand if we can correctly model primary recovery. And we have gone too fast. Now we are discussing about enhanced oil recovery. So that's kind of mind-blowing, but that's where we are.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Oskan. So we have another question over here. It says, in oil reservoir, CO2 flooding makes emulsions, and also foam when water cut is important. How does this affect the recovery in unconventionals?
So that's, I think foam has come up in the discussions a lot, and it's simply because when you inject some gas into the formation, especially a naturally fractured system, You don't want it to take the fractured parts and go away, because most of the time the strained fluid, it's in the matrix system. So you want the injected gas to go into the matrix. So you want to block the fractured channels. But in terms of foam injection, one of the problems is that you need to control the foam also, because you need your gas to penetrate into fractured system. From fractures, you want it to go into the matrix. So if you can do it extremely controlled, you can just inject the foam and make sure that it goes to the boundary of your intended reservoir and blocks the fractures at this point, but not inside. That might work, but we have heard some concerns that this can create some damage in the fracture systems.
Okay.
So that's one thing. And the CO2, actually a miscibility concept for CO2 is still debatable for unconventionals. And one thing we can say that for example, oil swelling type of discussions, they are not very appealing to me, because I don't want to swell the oil. I want to strip more hydrocarbons from it. And of course, vaporization is another concept. Condensation, vaporization type of things might be working. So we do not necessarily understand which aspect of CO2 is helping production or will help production in unconventionals, but trying to directly apply what we know from conventional systems is going to be a mistake, because we are dealing with an unconventional system.
Okay, yeah, thank you, Dr. Boscan. So we have a comment and also a question related to the comment. So it says, Mauricio, I have done some several experiments with CO2 and nitrogen in miscibility tests, and indeed nitrogen is usually much less effective. I have been trying a combination of a slug of alcohol and CO2 to reduce the minimum miscibility pressure, and it has worked. What is your opinion about this, as you mentioned that economics is not the most important aspect?
Again, let me correct it. Economics is probably the most important aspect, but economics cannot decide which mechanism is going to work. That's what I was saying.
Okay.
So you cannot just choose a system based on economics. You have to choose it based on the technical considerations and then decide if it's economic or not. So that's the comment I made. In terms of miscibilities, I think the issue here is that you can decide on miscibilities or make a lot of tests in the lab, in test tubes. But you need to think about this whole thing in 5 to 10 nanometer pore size, where you have only a few molecules. So when you talk about miscibility, you have to bring it down to this molecular level. It is not the same concept. There is one more thing. Miscibility pressure is a function of pore space, pore size too. So if your pore size becomes smaller and smaller, your miscibility pressure is going to go down too. So we have not really investigated these aspects enough. So I would not like to make a comment exactly on the question, because there are a lot of unknowns at the moment, but definitely we need to test different things. And once we show something in a test tube, we definitely need to put it into a confined environment. And for that reason, we are running a lot of nanofluidics tests in my group. So these are nanopore systems, and we look at them under a microscope, and we try to run these PVT experiments under a microscope in pore channels, so that we can understand the PVT behavior in these small confined pod spaces. But even when you go there, you run into a lot of issues, because if you have a 5-10 nanometer, even a 100 nanometer pod channel, how do you measure the pressure in that thing? Because you cannot insert a probe, you basically distort the behavior, and you need to have the pressure exactly at the location where the phase change occurs. So we have been trying to develop some pressure sensing methods by using laser light and things like that. And this is just to show the unconventional nature of the research in this area. A lot of the conventional tools we are using right now, they are not even capable of providing the answers we are looking for. So I guess we are going to continue more and more, but I would suggest that if they have some results in terms of miscibility pressures, they find a way to test those in a confined environment and see how it interacts with the in-situ fluids in a confined environment.
Okay, so based on that one, for example, Dr. Oskan, you were talking about this bulk behavior, and for example, we know that from PVT, all fluid properties, they change, as you said, when you are in a bulk system or in a confined system. So you have to change the fluid properties and everything, and also the phase envelope and so on. And now you are telling us also that for each nanopore, we can say we might have to need to get the miscibility pressure in that pore. Is that right?
Well, almost like this. In fact, you know, your bubble point pressure is going to be different in each pore. So what is the consequence of this? The most severe consequence is going to be at the same pressure, global pressure level, you're going to have a very heterogeneous phase distribution. At the same pressure, in different pore sizes, you may have different fluid saturations. And that's why we also had a lot of interest in going into these anomalous diffusion type of concepts. Most people think that anomalous diffusion is only for pore scale petrophysical heterogeneity. But in my opinion, we need these anomalous diffusion models because of the existing pore scale fluid saturation heterogeneities. So there are a lot of new concepts which are coming into this discussion. But the most important thing is, when we talk about size dependence of PVT behavior, bubble point pressure, capillary pressure, so on and so forth, we are not saying that at a given pore size, you're going to have this type of behavior. In fact, we are saying that you have a very strong compositional distribution in the field, and this is probably what determines your flow. A good example was a simulation model we ran, which showed that if you use the average pore sizes in a given matrix plug and reduce the pressure, at some point, gas came out of the system and then it started flowing and started increasing. But when we distributed the same average into different pores, different size pores, coming up with the same average, eventually gas came out, but because it could not form a continuous phase, it was not flowing. So your GOR was completely different. So it's not just about the size, it's also the distribution of these sizes. Unless you form a continuous phase, there is no flow, for example. Okay? So these issues are not really constant in our usual modeling at this point.
Okay, perfect. Thank you, Dr. Oskan. So we have another question related to, I will say, to the last slides that you presented, that it was about this clay swelling, that you mentioned about this water is going to make the clays to swell and everything. So we have this question. I do not understand how liberation of water will enhance permeability due to reduction of the pore diameter. Can you elaborate on this?
Well, basically, clay swelling is because of the water going into the clay. Okay? So what CO, carbon monoxide, does is to liberate the water, take water out of the clay. So when water goes out of the clay, then shale, it shrinks, and the pore space among shale, it increases. So that was the mechanism. And an interesting observation, there was some field experiments and everything, and then we tried it with some pores, and we saw nothing, no increase. And then we basically analyzed the content of the core, and the piece of core we had had very little clay in it. So again, this type of approach would only work if you had large clay content, and because of the existence of either in-situ or injected water in the system, this clay swells and blocks the pore channels. So it's just an example to show that there may be different mechanisms we can discover.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Oskar. Another question from Roxana Lopez is, she's asking, is there any way that CO2 injection affects the natural fracture porosity or not? The porosity from natural fractures?
We have not observed anything at this point. But if you are talking about the natural fractures, that was definitely not the topic of my discussion today, because now I make these presentations to some groups. Like, for example, if you go to University of Texas at Austin, they discuss a lot of surfactant type of things, because that's their specialty.
Okay.
These types of techniques are much more effective in the fracture network. What I was focusing on was the matrix system, very small pore spaces. So we have not really looked at what CO2 does in the fracture network. I mean, if it enhances the fracture porosity or permeability or whatever, there may be some different but more conventional type of effects for CO2 in the fracture network. But we have not done much in this area.
Okay, no, that's good. It is just, like I would say, curiosity from this from the audience. Yeah, I would say.
Certainly, and you know, it also shows two aspects of UR applications in unconventionals. One of them is some people think that if you start applying UR at a very early time, you may still have considerable oil stuck in the fracture network. So you may design your EOR strategy based on recovering this fluid in the fracture network. Then pretty much none of the things I discussed today would be considered in that type of mechanism, because you're not looking at a nanopore system. But if you apply it at a later term, or if you are looking at EOR for a much longer term for a broader enhanced oil recovery project, then you need to focus on where the fluid is stored, which is the nanopore matrix. Then you need to look at the different, more unconventional type of aspects.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Oskar. So we have here another one that is, how likely do you think that is that companies invest significantly on conventional EOR studies and pilots after accounting for market conditions and tight economics?
That's an interesting concept, even with these tight economics. There seems to be several, I'm not going to say a lot, but there are several pilot projects are being run.
Okay.
And there are some incentives to do that type of projects, especially if you, for example, if you can inject produce gas, that gives you some advantage, like you don't have to get rid of it. you make a good impact in the eye of the public and things like this. So companies are looking at it from multiple perspectives. But at the end of the day, if for example, this is my personal opinion, and I'm definitely willing to accept any other challenge. But if you try to capture CO2 from the air and then compress it and inject it, that's a very inefficient process, very costly. So in that case, your CO2, I mean, your EUR application is not going to be probably profitable. So you don't go in that direction. There is another issue. The biggest problem in EUR applications is containment. So you inject the fluid from one well, and you are not looking into a displacement process because you cannot displace fluid in the tight matrix. So you're looking at other mechanisms. If you inject the fluid into one well, and if you don't know where it goes through the fracture network, that's a problem. You don't know where to produce. Okay? Mm-hmm. So the next option is you design a huff and puff project where pretty much all the wells in a given pad, they inject for a period of time. So you soak the system for a while, and then you open all the wells and you produce. So you don't need to worry about where the gas goes. If not that well, it goes to the other one and you're going to produce from that one too. That's a good approach. But the problem in this case, you need to have the compression capacity in the field. So most companies right now are concerned about how much compression capability they need. And also that's a cost concentration. You can start with some small compression system, but if you need a larger scale project, you may not be able to build more. And some companies are looking for portable compression systems. So when they develop the process in the field, they can carry it from one place to the next. And there is also some concentration like a service business. I mean, gas compression is also being outsourced. Some other companies, not the producing company, but they can do this. So there is a very dynamic situation in terms of field application concentrations at this point. But it's amazing that the current oil price and the downturn and everything, it did not really kill this idea. So it's still going on. That's good news.
Well, yeah, those are good news, as you said, because at the end, the idea is to improve the recovery from those unconventionals. And as you said, even with this downturn and low oil prices and everything, they are still investing in those pilots and everything, yeah?
Oh, yeah. And again, most of our discussion in this talk was from a reservoir perspective. But it seems to me that one of the big bottlenecks would be at the surface. So if you create this huge compression system at the surface, there is a cost associated with it. Mm-hmm. And then if you try to implement it in a large field scale, then you're going to have all these very high pressure piping system going into the wellheads. And it's definitely a danger for the field applications. So a lot of companies are also looking at it in terms of safety issues. So there are a lot of moving parts at the moment. We need to understand that just because you come up with an idea from the reservoir side, that may not be applicable because of some surface restrictions to you.
So based on whatever you said, Dr. Oskan, it will be really good to perform some studies connected or coupling the surface with the subsurface, yeah? Having this surface, I don't know, facilities and everything, software connecting everything with the reservoir simulation, for example, models and everything, yeah? That would be the idea.
Certainly, but You know, that's again, there were some questions like this, but think about some miscible-based process, miscibility-based process. Then you're going to need the high pressure injection into these systems. So that requires a very large-scale compression and stuff at the surface and large volumes of gas. But at the same time, you also realize that if you inject the gas into very small pore space, then you need probably lower miscibility pressures.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to combine all these different aspects to find out the optimum conditions, what you can really accomplish. But there is, it's the reality. You cannot just design something based on underground conditions. Wellbore and the surface are going to be important and a big part of the cost.
Okay. Yeah. Well, so I will say that the last question is this one. It's related to, do you think that for modeling this unconventional, we should be using this apparent permeability concept, or we should go for more robust studies like molecular dynamics, like the ones that you presented today? Yeah.
Well, first of all these molecular dynamics simulations and discussions about the molecular level interactions and everything, I'm an engineer. So I try to understand the problem at molecular scale, but I also realize that we cannot apply it at molecular scale. So if we are going to do some field scale simulation, it's not going to be based on molecular dynamics and things like this. So if we are going to learn at that scale, we are going to come up with some proxy concepts so that we can predict the outcome. So the biggest issue in unconventionals is upscaling.
Mm-hmm.
Our knowledge, our perceptions are based on some upscaled models from conventionals. That's why we backed up and we went all the way to the molecular level, try to re-understand, recapture the physics. But now we are reaching a level, once we understand the physics, then we are going to upscale it to a level where we can use in practical applications. So we are in either extreme at this point. We are either too practical, disconnect from the molecular level realities, or mm-hmm. we are at the molecular level, but too far away from the application reality.
Okay. Yeah. That's a good way to put everything. Yeah. There is a gap. Yeah. There is a gap over there to connect that one. Yeah. From going upscaling, from the molecular scale to the reservoir scale. Yeah.
Yeah. Upscaling is based on right now, upscaling is an averaging process, volume averaging process. But dealing with the molecular level problems and pore scale heterogeneities and everything, you cross the boundary of continuum. And at this point, there's volumetric averaging and upscaling does not work. So we need to come up with new upscaling concepts too.
Okay. Yeah, that's a good topic for research there, Dr. Oskar.
Of course.
Okay.
It's a hard one.
It's a hard one, yeah, a difficult one. Okay, yeah. Dr. Oskar, I think I have already read all the questions. I don't know if you got some other ones just to you.
No, except that one.
In Spanish, yeah.
In Spanish, I think probably I can see gracias, so that's the starting part. Seems like there is nothing quite controversial, and if I'm missing something, I apologize, but other than that, I don't see anything.
Okay, mind. Well, so thank you so much, Dr. Oskar. So I'm gonna get again the role of presenter just to wrap up everything and conclude the webinar. Yeah, so you wanna say something, Dr. Oskar?
Well, I would like to thank you for inviting me, and it was a pleasure to talk to you, and I also appreciate all the questions coming from the audience. They were good discussions, and I wish you all a wonderful rest of the day.
Okay, yeah, so let's, thank you, Dr. Oskan. So let's just move with the last part of the presentation, yeah, of the webinar. So please let me know, Dr. Oskan, can you see the screen?
Yes.
Okay, well, so thank you so much, Dr. Oskan. So we really appreciate your participation in this project. So on behalf of Universidad Nacional Autónoma de México, UNAM, the School of Engineering, Division of Earth Sciences Engineering, and this project that is called Ponencias DICT, here we awards this certificate of participation to Dr. Oskan Erdal Oskan for his outstanding presentation, Big Solutions to Small Problems, as part of the series, as I mentioned before, of these webinars, technical webinars organized by Ponencias DICT. The slogan is Bridging the Industry with the Academia, and today is November 27, 2020. And it's signed, the certificate is signed by myself, Bruno Armando López Jiménez, assistant professor in the Department of Petroleum Engineering. So we have also the signature of the head of the Department of Petroleum Engineering, Israel Castro Herrera. And last but not least, the head of the Division of Earth Sciences Engineering, Dr. Enrique González Torres. So, Dr. Oskan, we're gonna make sure that you get this this certificate in a digital version. We are gonna send this by email. So we really appreciate your participation today. Yeah.
I appreciate it and thank you for this certificate.
Okay, there you are. So with that said, I just wanna thank the audience. Thank you for staying with us today. Until this time. So thank you for the questions. Thank you also for the interaction through the poll. And you are more than welcome to attend the next webinar that is going to be on December 11th, 2020. And this one is going to be given in Spanish. The title is right there. Yeah, and it's going to be given by Ulises Neri Flores. So the registration will be available soon. And as I said before, please stay connected with us. Through the social media and our email. Yeah, so please enjoy your weekend. Yeah, thank you for the attendance. And Dr. Oskan, we really appreciate your cooperation with us. Yeah, so to your collaboration with us. Okay, thank you, Dr. Oskan.
Thank you very much.
Okay, see you next time and enjoy your weekend.
Thank you.
Bye.